Hello, welcome to Business Finland. Today we are shooting the third session of our Nordic procurement training sessions. We have had a session on Sweden and Norway, and the videos are available, and today we're discussing Denmark. And to walk us through to the procurement issues in Denmark, we have Peter Isaksen today with us, and I think I will just give the floor for you right away.
Okay. Thank you. And thank you all for coming. As you can see, Peter Isaksen. I'll just talk shortly about myself, my company, what I do, and then I'll go into the presentation about public procurement in Denmark. First of all, I work as an independent consultant focused on helping foreign companies participate in tenders in Denmark, focused on the Danish public sector. As I said, focused on tenders, focused on market introduction. So helping to get in contact with the right people in the municipalities and the regions, so on. I'll just show you a short overview of what I'm going to talk about. First, I'll talk about European public procurement, because of course some of the rules that applies in Denmark applies everywhere. So I'll just talk shortly about the principles, the legal framework, and the thresholds. Then I'll talk about public procurement in Denmark, about some facts and figures, the landscape, so basically the division in Denmark, municipalities, regions, states, so on. I'll talk about procurement corporations in Denmark, and I'll talk about stakeholders and tenders or PPI, so public-private innovation. I'll talk about the specific tender participation, both what types of tenders do we have, the tender process. I'll talk about selection and awarding, tender publication and platforms. And then in the end, I'll talk about introduction of innovative medical technology, which is probably, hopefully, of interest to all of you. Here about health technology assessment, public-private innovation, and health tech networks in Denmark for companies, for public institutions. So, first, European public procurement. The EU treaty principles guide basically everything in the European Union and also the public procurement law. Of course, non-discrimination means that no country, no municipality can make a tender that is specified for companies in that country, in that area. So it means that you guys, as Finnish companies, have the same rights in Denmark as Danish companies. Equal treatment, everyone receives the same information, so that everyone has the same possibility to write a bid. Transparency, it's very clear what the process is, how is everything going to be evaluated, and proportionality. This is often one of the things that are problematic in tenders, in that they will have requirements for example, references that need to be way higher than what is reasonable for the contract that they offer. I will mention these in the context of some of the other parts later. And of course, mutual recognition, also of course a very important principle within the European Union. You can't say that, well, a given nurse, for example, that works as a product specialist for your company has to be educated as a nurse in Denmark. We recognize the educations of people from other EU member states. We recognize certificates and so on. So, these principles are, of course, the same in Denmark as they are here. The legal framework, also the same. It's the directive on public procurement. In Denmark, this is called Udbudsloven, enforced since 2016. And then we have the national complaints boards in Denmark that's called Klagenævnet for Udbud. So they monitor if everything is going as it should, independent, and this is where you can complain in case you have been mistreated, basically, in the tender process. So the thresholds also, this will probably be recognizable. They're also set by the European Commission. They every 2 years, they set a new threshold. I've calculated this backwards from the current Danish threshold. So it might, depending on the current currency, it might be off by a couple of thousand, but this should be recognizable. Of course, the difference here between goods and services for local or for state level. So the calculation is mostly if you sell a product to a given entity in Denmark and it exceeds 50,000 euros a year, it needs to be tendered, EU tendered. Again, all numbers are calculated over 4 years. Then we go to the Danish public procurement. So the public sector in Denmark purchases goods and services for around 40 billion euros a year. The state is responsible for about 12% of that, the regions about the same, 13%, and then the municipalities are responsible for the rest. Only contracts with a value of over 500,000 kroner, so 67,000 euros, needs to be tendered. So we have tenders below the threshold, so that's from 67,000 to 213,000, as I mentioned before. That's one type of tender, and then we have EU tenders above that. But up to 67,000, you can sell your product services without it needing to be tendered. There are about 1,700 tenders per year in Denmark, and Denmark has a very high transparency. There is very low corruption in Denmark, which is good in regards to having an overview of the processes and everything, but it also makes every process that you have with the Danish system long. I realize that this is probably not very different from Finland, but for some countries this is a difference, of course. So the landscape. Denmark is divided into five regions, and the regions are almost solely responsible for hospitals. They have a couple of other responsibilities, but it's very, very little. They are technically political organizations, so there is, you know, elections for the regions, but in reality, there is not much difference. I mean, they are more technocratic in nature, really. And that is written down here, their responsibilities, but as you can see, hospitals and psychiatric care and special institutions for the disabled are the main points. Then we have the municipalities. They are responsible for nursing homes, for home care, but the municipalities are also responsible, of course, for many, many other things. So this is just one of the areas of responsibility. And they are much more politically run entities. So what might be true in one municipality in regards to the focus that they have, for example, treatment or you know, helping dementia patients in their home and so on, might not be the focus in another municipality. So here in your contact with the Danish market, this is a very good thing to research before you start contacting municipalities. And many of them have very clear plans for what is our focus areas in the next 5 years in regards to elder care, for example, and so on. The differences of the municipalities is also quite immense. The smallest municipality in Denmark is here, Læsø. 1,800 people live there. And the biggest municipality, of course, is Copenhagen with 623,000. The ironic thing is, of course, that that the thresholds is the same for both of them. So Copenhagen municipality has to basically tender everything because they will always go above, while Læsø is, it's of course much smaller and can purchase a lot of things without having to tender it. So regional purchasing. Most of the regional purchases are part of tendered contracts. And one of the issues or challenges often is that while your product might technically not be bought to a degree where it goes above the thresholds, the region might consider it a part of a type of product where the entire type is above. So for example, if you sell a hygiene-related product, it might be included in a hygiene tender, and therefore, you will be included. One of the other challenges is that they often make products with, 500 product lines, and if you supply four of them, and it's not divided into part agreements, which is often not, you need a distributor in Denmark to participate. So this is often the challenge or the reality. Large centralized purchasing. Most of the hospitals in Denmark, if you try to find their purchasing department, it will be specified. Contact the region. These are the people who are responsible for both contact in regards to new products. But also just general purchasing. That doesn't mean that there's not a possibility in Denmark of being in direct contact with, for example, a wound department in a hospital and have them look at your products and so on. That is possible. But from there to the hospital region actually starting to purchase it, the centralized purchasing will most often have to be included. And again, one of the challenges, integration with current systems and registration in purchasing systems, which is always necessary before you can start selling anything. So the regions also work together on some contracts. There is cooperation sometimes between some of the regions, sometimes all of the regions. For example, with purchasing of ambulance helicopters, all of the regions did that together, the same with hearing aids, video conferencing equipment. So you can have the entire country covered basically in one tender. Another thing they also tend to do is that they make tenders where there's options. So for example, there is currently a ECG device tender running in Denmark, which is being run by this region, Sjælland. So the second smallest region in Denmark. They are the tenderer. All the other regions are connected to it with options, which means that after the bids and everything has been handed in, they can choose to say, oh, this is very good products at a very good price. We want to also have this contract. They can also choose not to. And of course, from a supplier perspective, this is quite a crazy situation when you're going to sit and evaluate, well, what will we offer? Because if none of the four that have options actually sign up to it afterwards, well, then the value of the contract is suddenly 14% of what it would have been if all of them signed up. So this is one of the challenges that is understandably of frustration. But with public procurement, it's all they have all the power, basically, and that's just the way it is, and it's a big frustration. But you know, I really wonder with this ECG tender, what their thinking was on this, because if they had all signed up before and not had an option, there's no doubt that the bids would have been better. Famously in Denmark, in one of the things that might have made more sense that they had all done together, they didn't. So for the electronic patient journals in the regions, they have different systems, and there was for a long time very big problems with these systems talking together. And if someone went from a hospital in one region to a hospital in another region, the transfer was problematic and so on. So, that's how it is. The municipal purchasing. So I said before, from 0 to 67,000, they don't have to tender. But a large part of the municipal purchasing of goods and services is not tendered. These numbers are in Danish kroner. So, but as you can see, you have quite a significant amount of the purchasing in these three example municipalities that is not tendered at all. Of course, as I mentioned before, for a municipality like Copenhagen, the numbers will be different, because they always end up over the threshold, or at least they do it a lot more than Jørgen, which is a very small municipality up here in the top of Denmark. So, municipal purchasing corporations is exactly as confusing as this map looks. We have all of these. It's impossible to say what do they purchase. There's no golden rule of, well, this type of product is always purchased through these corporations. Also within these corporations, you sometimes see in Kommunalbud, for example, that they have a tender, and then four of their municipalities have chosen not to participate in that tender. The reason why it's important to watch out for these is that while you might be in contact with one municipality, let's say a nursing home in a municipality, that nursing home will say, well, you know, we don't buy this product as it is. We can work together with you. And within our municipality, I don't know of any plan to actually start purchasing this product on a tender. That doesn't mean that the tender corporation that municipality is a part of is not currently working towards a big common tender. So you could risk, if this is not being looked into in advance, that you're going to work with a nursing home for a while, implement and so on, and then down the line there is a tender that will then make it so that nursing home now has to buy your type of product from this contract. So that's why it's important to be aware that the individual municipalities' tender plans is one thing, but also the purchasing corporations that municipality is part of is important to keep track of. So this SKI is one of the most important, largest purchasing organizations in Denmark. It is Staten og Kommunernes Indkøbsservice, so the state and the municipalities together. Very large contracts, many customers. Some of these tenders, we're talking 80 municipalities that are a part of that and now has to buy on a given contract. Usually it's standard services and goods. But they have, for example, health articles as one of their products or one of their tenders, with I think it's 1,500 different products that are included in that, and it's an important part to keep track of what are they going to do next time, right? Because you can risk, and I've seen this before, that you work with a municipality, you win a tender there, and everything is going great. And then, you know, 3 years into your contract with them, when you think that they're about to prepare, you know, tendering it one more time, it turns out that your product has now been included in a massive tender from SKI, and is now a one distributor deal with, 2,000 products, 1,500 products, and now you can't supply this municipality anymore. They are going to sign up to that, and this contract is not going to be renewed. I mean, this is not something that happens constantly, but it's something to be aware of, that this is a risk, and something to be in contact with the municipality about what are you actually working towards. So that's why I included here. In your contact with the municipalities, it's very important, of course, to have a good overview of the relevant stakeholders, the decision makers, so purchasing department or the person in charge of elder care and so on. Often companies find it easy, of course, to be in direct contact with a nursing home, for example, and test, implement, but then you have to do that again with the next nursing home and the next nursing home. There is a transferability that is very low, while if you work at municipal level from the beginning, then there is the possibility of testing in one nursing home, and on the basis of that, decide to implement in all nursing homes, which in could be from anywhere from 5 to 45 customers that you can then get at the same time. So of course here in the communication with the decision makers, the important thing is to focus on, of course, economy, but business case. Business case is, in Danish, it's also business case. So it's a concept that the municipalities use again and again for an evaluation of a product's return on investment and cost benefit analysis and so on. So influences, specialized personnel within the municipality, so wound care nurses or whoever is relevant for your product or technology. Of course, here you communicate much more at a technology specific level. The users, again, the people who are actually going to be using the product from day to day, and the gatekeepers. And I'll talk about the gatekeepers again in the end, because I think that the gatekeepers are the most important ones here, because they're gatekeepers for a reason, but they also understand how to influence all of the other people in this stakeholder map. And then, of course, we have the ambassadors, so the people that are excited about your concept, your product, and so on within the municipality, and they can be located really anywhere. So that gets me to the question of tender or public-private innovation. The reason for this is that I'm sure many of you are making products that are new and therefore are not being tendered. The municipalities, regions, anyone only tender what they already know they need, right? So I would say everyone should consider for themselves where on this these lines your product concept lies, and on the basis of that decide how to approach the Danish market. So of course, low complexity and a mature market, it will be tendered. And high complexity and non-mature market, we're talking pre-commercial purchasing and public-private innovation. So, tender participation. You've done this and you've decided we are here, right? So we're looking at the tenders in Denmark. And we have 7 types of tenders. The first is open procedure. It's the same as everywhere else. Anyone that can supply a product or a service can participate, no matter where they're from in the European Union. We have the restricted procedure, where you ask for pre-qualification. A small number of companies are pre-qualified, and those companies are invited to give a bid. Then we have the negotiated procedure, where the purchasing organization will go into a negotiation with the companies that have given them the bids. So it's very related to the restricted procedure. So project competition, this is usually done with architecture, city planning, so on. Usually they then, as the first thing, once they've given the contract to someone that has won a, you know, for example, building a new hospital in Denmark, is that they then change everything about the plans that the company has won with. But that's, yeah, that's how it is. Competitive dialogue, only used with very complex contracts. Where the first phase is basically the bidding phase, and then you go to first the dialogue phase, of course, and then the bidding phase. Sorry. So, dynamic purchasing systems, where you get the possibility to sell a group of products. So, for example, in a municipality, this could be used to sell groceries to all their institutions. So it's not that applicable for your types of products. And innovation partnerships. So this is one of the most interesting types of tenders. Basically, they will go out and say, well, we want to invent a solution to this problem, or we want to develop a new way of working with this and this. And then on the basis of a bid or a concept proposal, they will choose the company that they will then develop this product or technology together with. This is the most interesting one if you're doing something very innovative, and especially if you're doing something that is not already on the Danish market. Because, of course, it's only used for things that is not already readily available. So, the tender process. Basically, a tender goes through these 6 steps. First, it's a part of the plan. We're going to tender this in 2020. Then they are preparing the tender, and this is the best point of influence. Of course, all companies want to influence what a tender looks like, and once the tender is actually published, it's very hard to do. It's only small parts of that you can get them to correct certain demand specifications and so on. But by being involved with the municipality, region, and so on, at much earlier stage, it's much more possible to guide them in the right direction in regards to how should they put together the demand specifications. And this, of course, gives some power, some influence often to companies. Where it's a dangerous thing to take too much advantage of, because you want, of course, to have the municipality that you're already working with, you've done a test and so on, now they're tendering, you want them to write a tender that you're going to win. That makes sense. But if you write it in a way where the demand specifications are so exactly your product and for arbitrary reasons are excluding your competitors, then the first thing that's going to happen once it's published is that all your competitors are going to say, this is bullshit. you are working together with this company and so on and so on. You need to change this, this, and this. And it's going to embarrass the municipality, but it's also, it's not going to fly. What you want to do is influence them to a degree where they are doing a tender that everyone can participate in, that, you know, not everyone, but you and your competitors, but where it's going to be evaluated in a way that your strong points are going to come to the fore, right? So this is, of course, a delicate thing to do, but it's where a lot of the what can I say, power of influence is. Some tenders are just go through this, right? So, but some tenders also have here, as part of this tender preparation, a formalized hearing phase where everyone can give their official reasonings and opinions on certain specific parts of the tender. So this is an important thing to keep track of and to give that information, because once that hearing phase is done and the tender materials are there, again, it's very hard to make any meaningful changes to it. Of course, then the tender happens, it's evaluated and awarded. I'll talk about that in a second. Then you implement and then you the contract runs. And then we go back again. So it's it should be a circle. I just have a short example of a typical tender timeline, so from a random tender, where first TD notice, questions deadline, deadline for handing in bid and samples, evaluation, clinical trial, and so on. So the timelines for this, so from TD notice publication to deadline for handing in bid and product samples is at minimum 30, 35 days, depending on which type of tender we're talking about. They rarely extend it a lot more than that. So this tender is a little bit special in that regard. So. Any given tender, you have selection and awarding. Selection is based on you, the company. And it's some clear criteria related to your profile, your economic power, and your technical skills. Economic power is usually based on turnover in the last 3 years, so on, and equity. And one of the things to consider if you want to participate in tenders in Denmark with a subsidiary is that you ensure that your subsidiary has a positive equity every year. What many companies do is they extract value from their subsidiaries every year, or the subsidiary has debts to the mother company and so on, so they have a negative equity, which is not good for your chances of participation in a given tender. So this is something to consider if you're going to have a subsidiary participate in tenders in Denmark. Often positive equity in the last 3 years is a requirement, but it doesn't say anything about the amount. You know, it's just that it's positive. And the technical skills. The technical skills are usually being shown with references. So similar contracts where you have to put in information about the turnover, what company, municipality, whatever is it, and a contact person. That's the minimum. Sometimes there's a requirement for a more extensive explanation of what you have done with a given reference. Then there's ESPD, the European Single Procurement document, which is a standardized document that you use here, we use in Denmark, all 28 member states. Then we have the awarding, and the awarding is based on your bid, on how well your offer fits to the requirements that have been specified in the tender materials. It's based on price. I see price is there twice. It is very important. And quality and service. So here, there is often a problem with public entities when they put out requirements. For example, they often have a tendency to put minimum requirements instead of putting out clear requirements that makes it possible to actually compete. But this is one of the things, again, where it's important to ask questions for them and get them to change accordingly. So an example of this could be that they're asking for a product to have a minimum thickness of, let's say, 5 centimeters, whatever the product, where it might be better if it's 10, but if yours is 6 and yours is 8, you're going to get the same amount of points because it's a minimum requirement, where instead they could have said, well, it needs to be minimum 5, but then for every centimeter over that, we're going to award 1 point so that the one with the 8 centimeters actually can be evaluated in the tender as being better than the one with 6 centimeters or 5 centimeters. So I'll just shortly talk about tender publication in Denmark. We have udbud.dk. I'll show a picture of it in just a second. They are only required to publish tender below the EU threshold on that page. And the reason for that is that it's connected to TED, where they have to publish all the tenders, all the EU tenders, above the 213,000 euro threshold. So if you go to udbud.dk, all the tenders are there. And then they're connected to platforms. And I'll just shortly show examples of two of the platforms, Ethics, EU Supply. We have others too in Denmark, but these are the two biggest ones. So udbud.dk, as you can change the language to English. Right here on this picture, there's only these three tenders are EU tenders, but if they're below the threshold, it will say over here. Then here we have the TED, Tenders Electronic Daily, where all tenders in the European Union are being published. So I'm sure if you do tenders in Finland, that this is known to you. So Ethics, again, as you can see, it's possible to have everything in English. So the platforms itself, it's the same with EU Supply, are possible to have in English, but the actual tender requirements and so on will, of course, be in Danish. But still, here, as you can see down here with the ESPD, you can create your ESPD response on this platform in English, in Finnish, as you will, and then in the end, you can extract the information in Danish and send it in. So that part of it is possible for you to do without any knowledge about the Danish language. So we come to introduction of innovative medical technology, where I'll talk a little bit about the assessment in Denmark, the two of the models that are used, and I'll talk a bit about public-private innovation. And examples of public-private innovation, and I'll show you a map of Denmark of these public-private innovation centers. So this is a model, the VTV model, the health technology assessment model that is used in a lot of the municipalities in Denmark. I would suggest that you consider all of the parameters in this before your contact with the municipalities. And the reason for this is that these are the parameters that they're going to be evaluating everything on anyway. And if you have a very clear story about your functionality and your operating costs, then that's great. But when they're going to then start figuring out how we're going to evaluate this entire technology, and they are looking at the clients is the patient, and looking at the culture and values within their organization, then they are going to decide on how to evaluate on that. I would always consider first, how would you like them to evaluate these things? What do you think your technology or product does in these areas? And then, of course, I mean, it's not like you can decide exactly how they're going to be evaluating, but at least you can guide them and tell them why it's important to include these aspects. Maybe it's not important to include those aspects and so on. Having one of these done is also, in my view, a great first step. It takes longer and it costs more resources and so on, but one of the challenges within the Danish system, I'm sure it's similar here, is that every municipality, every region you go to, they think that they're special, you know, and they will tell you that, yeah, this might work with people with dementia in Viborg, but this is Aarhus, and it's a completely different group of patients we have here. You know, that is a challenge. And they will probably insist on testing out your system anyway. But if you go to them with something like this, where they can see that Viborg municipality used the same model as they're about to use, then the chance of you being able to transfer results to them and have them actually consider this okay validation is much higher. So that should be considered. Then we have the model of model for assessment of telemedicine. So here again, it's similar, but this is used more within the regions, and as the name you know, tells you, it's also most for telehealth. But again, you know, you start out by talking about the health problem, your proposed solution, your technology, the safety of this, clinical effectiveness, patient perspectives, economic aspects, organizational aspects, and social, cultural, ethical, and legal aspects of your concept product, so on. So all of these things you should have a pretty good answer to, an idea about in your contact with the public sector in Denmark. So examples of OPI. One of them is in Fredericia municipality, where they decided in some nursing homes to install touchscreens in the rooms of or in the apartments of the patients, which meant that they could do registration immediately. It was also installed in home care, which made it easier for them to do registration and saved 12 minutes per resident. So this is a project that was run out of the OPI, as it's called in Denmark. OPI and PPI is the same thing. It's just OPI is the Danish word for it. Offentlig privat innovation. Yeah, The other one is introduction in the region of southern Denmark at Odense University Hospital, where they made a development cooperation about IT in the intensive and anesthesia departments, and where they did a more systematic registration of patient information. So this is just two really random examples, but I'm sure that whatever product technology that you're working with, you know, similar projects like this could be done. And that leads me to the map of Denmark. So I'll explain the colors in a second, but this is an interactive map that you can go to. I can send you the links to all of these things if you want it. Basically, on a regional perspective, we have something like VTEC in the capital region, responsible for assessment of new technologies. These are the gatekeepers I was talking about before, and the people that I would argue is most important to get in contact with and to get on board, because they can open the doors, or the gate, to all the other parts of the region, and they know exactly what are the projects that they're running. They know how to get financing for the project, who to include, and so on. So the different regions have different centers for this. In southern Denmark, they have the Southern Danish Health Innovation. For the municipal, as you can see, we have the 98 municipalities on here. Fewer of them have these. The reason is that for you to actually build up a proper department for this is, I suppose, expensive. And therefore, many of the smaller municipalities don't have centers as such. But they all have someone that is responsible for health technology assessment in some degree. And these are really the people that are interesting for you guys to be in contact with. Then there's also hybrid ones, where it's projects that cross the line between municipal and regional. So where a product can work with both, or where several municipalities might be working together, and then the state have some centers too for the laboratory for welfare technology, for example, and the department for digital development and innovation. So, again, just an example. The CIMT, it is this one here. It's connected to the university hospital. And as you can see, website in English. And they work both with international projects. They work, as I said, municipal, regional. So this might also be an interesting avenue to look at. Are there any projects where something like CIMT is working with a Finnish organization and so on? So, and then on my second to last slide, health tech networks in Denmark. So basically we have the CareNet is mostly related to the municipalities. It's an organization for companies and municipalities together, so knowledge organization for health technology. And it is run by the Technological Institute in Denmark, which is also the institute that developed the model, the first model I was talking about, the one with all the colors. So these municipalities that are there are used to working with that model. This is an interesting thing to consider membership of if you're going to make a Danish subsidiary, as a startup, it can become member of an organization like this for like 700 euros or something like that. So an insignificant amount, but something that gives you access to a lot of relevant people in the municipality. And then welfare tech. Welfare tech has quite a significant role in the PPI, the public-private innovation. They work on guides for public-private innovation, and again, membership of this relatively cheap for a startup, and again, they help a lot with facilitating contact between companies and the relevant people in the municipalities and regions and so on. So that was it. If you want more information, you can contact Terry or me directly. And of course, if any of you are interested in having a Skype call about the Danish public sector, how your technology could fit within that, I would be open to that, of course. Okay, thank you.